Welcome back, friends. In this video tutorial, we'll be talking about electrophoresis in a whole. And majorly, we'll be talking about the gel electrophoresis and the different types of electrophoresis that are available and what we do using those electrophoresis techniques. So first things first, what is electrophoresis? Now, electrophoresis, so let me first take a color here. Electrophoresis is a technique. Electrophoresis is a technique, or you know, technique that is widely used in biology as well as in chemistry and all purposes to separate different molecules based on their charge, shape and size, right? Majorly, if you look at the biological point of view, electrophoresis is a technique to separate DNA or proteins most of the time based on their charge, shape and size. I mean, based on their molecular weight and charge and shape and all these things. Why? Due to the application of an electric field. Now, normally a biological molecule, or any molecule if you take, let's say this is a biological molecule, let's say it's a protein. Normally that thing is not having a kind of a charge thing. And if you place them in a neutral region, I mean a neutral electric field, it will not migrate, it will not move. But if we apply two opposite electric field in both this direction, like positive and negative electric field, so it start to create an electric flow, electron flow. So as this electron flow start to happen, in this case this protein particles and any other thing like proteins or DNA, let's say the protein is tagged with some negative charge, in that case if it is having a kind of charge, based on that electric field, this charge will have such either repulsion or attraction. For example, if it is in negative charge protein, obviously in that case it will have a repulsion from negative end, so it will migrate towards this positive end. Now if it is in positive charge condition, then it will repel from positive end and migrate towards the negative end. That's what happens, because let's say in case of DNA, it is negatively stranded, I mean negatively charged. So let's say this is again a positive and a negative terminal. We add all these things, we create this this electric field, and then we apply the DNA. Let's say the DNA is added. Let's say here is the DNA. This is the DNA that is placed. Now DNA is negatively charged. Remember, if we place the DNA somewhere here, it is having a tendency to migrate towards the positive end, because the DNA is having the phosphate at their backbone and the phosphate is negatively charged, right? So DNA will move from negative to the positive end of the electrophoretic field. So this is called electrophoretic field, and the technique to separate different molecule based on their charge, shape and size are called as electrophoresis. Now the thing is, how can you separate based on charge, shape and size? The charge plays a vital role, and we all know that by these two explanations that I've given you. But shape and size play also vital roles. Normally we talk about the size or the molecular weight of the molecule. In that case, the thing is, what we do in electrophoresis, I mean, we produce a medium. The medium is made with polymers, polymer of sugar, or that are called, either it can be agarose, it can be polyacrylamide, and many more different type of polymers can be there. It can be any starch polymer, in case of, it can be starch, in case of starch as well as the paper electrophoresis. So all these things are polymers. Now those polymer create a network. Let's say these are the different units, and they create the, what they create is a net or mesh of network. So this network having small pores in it, so small holes, as you can see this pores are there, uneven pores in different regions. So as they create pore in this case, and we have, well, let's say we are having a mixture of particles. We have this blue, we are having these red ones, we are having the green ones are middle, and let's black one won't work. So let's say the red ones are very, very small. So let's say we are having all these things out there. Blue ones are larger. So let's say we are having the mixture of particles like that. And if we add them in this network and apply this electric field, it will migrate from the repulsing field towards the attractive field, right? And once it is migrating, it will obviously start their journey through all these pores that are created by this network. And once they are traveling through these pores, the smaller molecules, as they're smaller and the charged particle, they will migrate to the longer distance, right? And the larger particles will migrate the shorter distance. So if you look at here in this network of mesh, we'll find that smaller particles will travel fast and further distance, larger particle travel slow and smaller distance. So then we can see what is called as a pattern or bands in those medium of polymer. So in the polymer we'll find all these bands, I mean different bands will be seen. Band means where exactly the DNA or protein is placed after the electrophoresis is done. So that's what we're talking about, because remember, though electrophoresis is a general term that can be used in chemistry, biochemistry, biology and all this field, but mainly here we'll be looking at the biological point of view of electrophoresis. So let's move on. So what are the different type of electrophoresis? Now the types can be of two major type, like a zone electrophoresis and a moving boundary electrophoresis. Now in zone electrophoresis, it can be paper electrophoresis, gel electrophoresis, thin layer electrophoresis, cellulose acetate electrophoresis. In all this case, paper, gel, thin layer and cellulose acetate. These are all type of zone electrophoresis, that is fixed to a particular area and movement is occurring through that area. On the other hand, moving boundary electrophoresis is another type of electrophoresis pathway. Moving boundary electrophoresis, and the examples are capillary electrophoresis, isotachophoresis, isoelectric focusing, immunoelectrophoresis. These are called moving boundary electrophoresis, because in this kind of electrophoresis, like capillary, isoelectric focusing, in this case of electrophoresis, not only the molecule or the molecule which will be separated is going towards a particular direction, but also they are interacting with their boundary or surroundings too. But in case of zone electrophoresis, the molecules or the particles are not, particles are moving from a particular direction to another direction through the electric field, but they are not interacting with their surroundings, they are not interacting with their surrounding zone. So they are kind of fixed at a particular zone, that's called zone electrophoresis. But moving boundary means the boundary of that electrophoresis, as you can see it here, it is interacting like capillary electrophoresis. You can see a different video on capillary electrophoresis in my YouTube channel, and you'll see that they will interact with that with the capillary wall. So this is a kind of moving boundary electrophoresis. Okay, and this is one type of division based on certain things, and we can, based on the separation of DNA and proteins, we can divide them in two parts. All of those process of separation of DNA and protein usually based on gel. So gel electrophoresis is most common in biological application, right? And if you look at the gel electrophoresis, we can divide them into, let's say, majorly two parts. One is agarose gel electrophoresis, where we use agarose as a polymer to create the network, or we can use polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis, which is used for proteins. Agarose gel electrophoresis are used for DNA separation. Okay, so what we can do, if we have a mixture of different DNA fragments as well as a mixture of proteins, we can separate those proteins and DNA fragments based on their size, shape and charge ratio using this electrophoresis pathway. Now the PAGE can be of two different type, conventional native PAGE and SDS PAGE. It can be SDS and native. I have all of these videos in my YouTube channel. You can check out each of those separate videos of native electrophoresis, SDS PAGE electrophoresis, for understanding in details. Now these are vigorously used in biology, because those molecules that are biological molecules are separated using the gel. It is better to separate them using gel. But mainly for the paper electrophoresis or capillary electrophoresis are used vigorously in chemistry lab, because all the different chemical molecules and also metallomics, in that case of metals and all these interactions, we use capillary electrophoresis to separate them out. And their kind of application is kind of same, just like the HPLC or gas chromatography out there. Now the principle of electrophoresis I've already discussed, but the idea here, we can see that there is an electric field. Remember, obviously there should be an electric field. Why? Because whatever charge your particle of separation is, if we add electric field, then it will influence the movement of that particular charged molecule through that electric field, either towards the same parallel to the electric field or opposite to that electric field. So as you can see here, there are two types of molecules, negative as well as positively charged molecule out here, and if we add the electric field to this direction, at this direction, and if we have let's say the negative charge and positive charge of electric field like this, and in this case this positively charged particle will definitely migrate or move towards the negatively end of our electric supply. Why? Because obviously this positive will attract, this negatively charged electrode will attract the positively charged particle here. So that is the thing, and this is called electrophoretic flow or electrophoretic movement through this electric field. Now if you look at here, you can see the principle. Actually in capillary also you can see that there are three types of particle can be present: negative, slightly positive, and a neutral type of particle. Now if you apply the same electric field, these three types of particle will behave differently. Let's say if you look at the movement towards positive to negative electrode, you will see the positively charged particle will migrate further and it will be attracted towards negative electrode. Obviously neutral will then come, and then at last if there will be negatively charged, because negatively charged particle will never migrate towards the negatively charged electrode because it's kind of a repulsion force that is going on. So obviously, there are electrophoretic force at a direction and there is a movement of the particle. This electrophoretic force and movement of particle can be at same direction or it can be at opposite direction. Now if you see here, it's a very basic representation of electrophoresis, that this is a cation and ions that are interchanging between buffers that are placed on two different electrode sections. One is the cathode, negatively charged, and anode, positively charged here, right? So two different electrodes are placed. Now buffers are also placed, a cathode type of buffer, anode buffer, both of the type of buffers are added, and they are added to the high voltage power supply. Now it depends on what kind of molecule you are separating. Based on the DNA and protein, we usually use 80 to 120 volt in normal cases, but not more than that. But for other chemical molecules and smaller molecules, we may need much more higher voltage. For example, in capillary electrophoresis, we use 1000 volt per inch electric supply for the process to work. So the reactions are provided here in cathode and anode. It's not that much important, or don't need to memorize all these things, but again the idea is here. So either you can use here at the middle. This is where all this actual thing takes place, the medium, exactly where it's going on, because the buffer is a solution where everything is placed, where the ions will move. That's why the buffers are provided, and you should never ever try this electrophoresis with plain water, because it never possible. You should have buffer in all biological systems. In whatever experiment you do, you should have the presence of buffer. Usually we use TAE, trace acetate EDTA buffer, or TAE buffer. Now buffers are pressed, but buffers are not the medium for the electrophoresis. For the medium here is acted by this polyacrylamide gel. So if you look at here, polyacrylamide gel acts as, or either polyacrylamide or agarose, the network will be made by agarose or polyacrylamide, and they will provide you this matrix where the electrophoresis will take place, where the DNA or protein will run and separate and give you bands. So once they give you bands, once they provide you bands, we can actually stain those bands to finally see where exactly the DNA is present in the band and the protein is present in the band, and so. So these are the different stages of electrophoresis. Method selection depends on what kind of method we'll use. Let's say we select agarose gel electrophoresis. In that case, we need to prepare the sample for it. Once we have the sample, we add a dye, a stain, so that we can visualize the movement of that sample during the electrophoresis in the gel. Third thing is the gel buffer preparation. We prepare the gel as well as buffer. This is very easy to prepare. For example, in case of gel preparation, agarose is a polymer. Once we add agarose in the water and then we heat it, once we heat it, those mixture will be clear and transparent. Then we set it to cool, and once we set it to cool, it will be solidified. Usually the agarose is used 1% to 2% based on the molecular weight of proteins or DNA we want to separate. So usually if we take 1% agar, which is very low concentration of agar, lower concentration of agar will produce the larger pores, and higher concentration of agars will create small pores. So, okay, so it depends on which situation or which system we want to use. Okay. Now, once we prepare that, then we perform the electrophoresis by connecting the electrodes properly as well as filling the buffers, filling the chambers with buffer. Once that thing is done, then we detect, once the run is complete, then we detect it by staining them. Now, the staining we can use for DNA, agarose gel electrophoresis is ETBR or ethidium bromide. But ethidium bromide is a kind of toxic because it's mutagenic in nature. So, you can use other types of stain out there. Non-toxic stains are in the market now. So, you can use it, but ultimately we'll stain it and we can visualize the presence of those DNA fragments, or in case of proteins, we can see the presence of proteins. And then we can also take that part of the gel out. We can degrade those gel and take that DNA or protein sequence out of it, and we can do the further processing with that protein or DNA. So, these are the different stages of gel electrophoresis, and I hope that's helpful. If you like this video, hit the like button, subscribe to this channel to get more videos like this and updates from me. Thank you for watching. Share this video with your friends. Thank you.